We will continue the series of studies on what we call scriptural answers to the errors of submission, covering, neo-discipleship, and shepherdship. And I want to stress particularly this morning shepherdship and new discipleship. As I continue to read and listen to the messages of these men concerning shepherdship and discipleship, which we've already shown you is not biblical, the authoritarianism of these men is quite awesome and fearsome because they do not hesitate to set themselves up as authorities and to bind others with it. Remember, we already said that if you're not submitted, then you're not in the kingdom, you're not in God's will, and you're open to deception. They set up those rules and principles, you see, and then everyone who is willing to accept that, then if they find someone who isn't accepting their principles, then here's what they call them. They say an unsubmitted ministry is potentially a rebel ministry. That's faith assembly. We're not submitted to some bishop or denominational system or leader or to one of their apostles that they've appointed. So an unsubmitted ministry is potentially a rebel ministry and therefore is in danger of falling into deception. Then listen to the confession that one of these leaders out of Florida makes. And you hear this all the time out of them, of deception, weakness, failure. He said, "For several years I was in that kind of exposed position and was most vulnerable to attack from the enemy. Looking back, I can see several occasions when I was deceived in certain matters and had no one to correct me." Now, here's one of the leaders. How do we know he isn't deceived now? So he went on to say he submitted himself to the other three in Florida, and now they correct him. Listen to the principles they set up. And, of course, this puts us into false ministry, rebellion, and everything else because we can't shape up to their principles. He's teaching here on false prophets. He said, "I would suggest at least three tests which seem universally applicable. If a minister fails in any one of these tests, it indicates he's a false prophet." So you have to accept the fact that the tests are valid, and then, of course, you can prove anything you want. So the first test is this, and we won't burden you with the others. Is he submitted to some delegated spiritual authority? Which, of course, you know, is their whole teaching. Anyone refusing to acknowledge the men who are in authority over him is a rebel. And rebellion is the basic characteristic of a false prophet. So because I'm not submitted to some head other than Jesus, because I'm not submitted to some man-appointed authority, because you're not, you are a false prophet, a false teacher. Well, you have to read those statements twice. I have to go back and run the tape back many times twice. I can't believe they're saying what they're saying. I ought to be able to believe it, but now I've been listening to it for months and reading it and studying it, but some of you said on this teaching from last week that you didn't know how bad covering submitted body teaching was, that you didn't know how unscriptural it was. And I've said to some of you, there's no way to communicate to you how bad it is. There's no way to stand up here and communicate. You would have to saturate yourself in it, as I have for several months, to believe it's that bad. And then you'd have to know the Word of God, first of all, to know the subtle deceptions that they're setting forth. Well, we want to get into neo-discipleship and shepherdship. And, of course, as I've said before, they follow Juan Carlos Ortiz, a pastor in South America, who is the source of much of their teaching. Ortiz said that the ministers in Buenos Aires submitted themselves to one another, and on all major decisions, they've agreed to follow the guidance of the whole group. Now, he's not talking about charismatic pastors, but liberals and what have you, the whole bit in any city, like you'd find it. And they agreed to follow the guidance of the whole group. Can you imagine the guidance you'd get on tongues or faith healing or the baptism of the Holy Spirit? What kind of guidance would you get down in Warsaw, for example, from all the pastors? He said, "I first submitted myself to the authority of all the pastors in the city, Baptist to Roman Catholic, and then I was eligible," he said, "to start making disciples in my own congregation." Now, remember, as we taught last week, they make an unscriptural distinction between a disciple and a Christian. We showed you Acts 11:26, that disciples and Christians are equated in the New Testament. Let's look at what R.T.'s calls the mechanics of discipleship, first of all, and then we'll begin to point out some of the errors of all of this. He says each disciple has 7 nights in the week. Well, quite a revelation. Look at what they're going to do with it. They take all your 7 nights. You talk about bondage. I thought Southern Baptists were the worst for bringing into bondage so that you didn't have time to brush your teeth with all of the committees and programs and religious ritual you have to go through in that system. But this is worse. This takes every night. 1 night is given to the cell. Now, they call their little meetings of disciples cells, and you know where that term comes from. Later on, he admits it isn't biblical. 1 night is given to the cell where the disciple receives. 2 nights, that makes 3, he gives. That is, he goes to meetings where he's giving out. You know, counseling and listening to people confess their sins to him and so forth. On a 4th night of the week, we all meet together. There's 4 of your nights. A 5th night is given to the family. This is a commandment. Commandment. We're talking about this as bondage. You're commanded. Single people must give the night to their families. That's a commandment. A 6th night is given to rest. This is a commandment. Well, now the commandment to rest was in the law. There's no commandment in the New Testament that we have to rest. You should rest, yes. But you're commanded to rest. And if you want to plant a garden on that 1 day you're off from the cell meeting, no, you can't do it. You have to rest. He says, we need this day. We command rest because we need it, since we seldom get to bed before 1 o'clock on the cell nights. This is why we stop meeting on Sunday mornings. We need to sleep. You have to read it twice. Everyone stays home and sleeps until 10 or 11 on Sunday morning. It's different, he says. The 7th night is for reinforcement. The only night you've got, you're under bondage, you're commanded to rest. If you wanted to do something else, you wouldn't be able to. 7th night is for reinforcement. Whatever element from the other 6 nights needs more attention gets it on the 7th night. The disciple goes to his leader to get spiritual help and so forth. Then once a month, all the cells meet together in the country for a weekend, Friday through Sunday. They share together, live together, confess their sins one to another. Well, you wouldn't have to know much about the Bible, friends, to know that all of these things that we're showing you is not scriptural. He says, what is a cell? He admits here that it is not a biblical term. A cell, it's a small group, 7 or 8 people. He says if it gets any larger, it becomes a church in itself. They don't like that. They tell you right now that you cannot establish a church in your house, or like we're meeting, that there's already a church in North Webster, and we're a part of it. Now, they mean that denominational system out there, friends. And that comes from one of the Florida leaders. Well, what is the nature of the cell? What do they do? He starts out by saying scientific studies tell us that people remember only 20% of what they hear. I thought it was less than that, but nevertheless. So he said because people remember only 20% of what they hear, that we shouldn't be preaching sermons or teaching the word whenever we meet together. He said that we only have 4 or 5 sermons a year, that is teachings. Now, because he said we're called to be doers of the word, not hearers. Notice how subtle the devil twists scripture. He said, since we began discipleship cells in 1971, we've had less than 20 messages. 71. This is a new book, just came out. You can figure out how many that is a year. He already said it, 4 or 5. See, the people are perishing for lack of knowledge now. They don't know the word. And now, under the guise of causing them to be doers of the word and not just hearers, the devil is getting them out of the word instead of in the word. That means Jesus wasted his time when he daily taught the word in the temple, we're told, and went about for 3 years teaching day and night. Paul was wasting his time when he spent a year, 6 months, 2 years, 3 years in places day by day. He said, daily I taught you. Where do these men get this? Not out of the Bible. What goes on? What do they talk about? Social issues, problems at home. That's the way they disciple one another. Here's a typical discipleship meeting. He says, we discuss things like wives be submissive to your own husbands. They really like that one because women have no place in this neo-discipleship. They're in total bondage. We discuss the kinds of things in the cells, like, let's say we have a lesson on husbands. Then the first week, we discuss all the material of that lesson. The second week, we review the material by questions and answers to make sure everyone understands what a husband is and how he should relate to his wife and children. The third week, we start over again with the first point. You can see why they only get through 4 or 5 a year. And the first point was the husband is the head of the home. So we discuss how to put it into practice. And the leader turns to one, he calls him here Roberto. Well, Roberto, are you the head of your house? Well, I tell you, Roberto says, we've really been through a problem here lately. I guess I'm not the head of my home because I don't know how to solve the problem. What happened? Well, my father-in-law died recently, and he had a big dog that he really loved. We had to bring my mother-in-law to live with us, and of course she had to bring along the dog since it reminded her of her husband. The trouble is, our apartment is too small for a dog, so we argue about it. I say the dog has to go. My wife says, poor mom, she's so old, the dog reminds her of daddy. Please be kind and let him stay. We're getting nowhere. I don't know if I even want to live there any longer, Roberto says. Someone in the cell says, I have a farm, let me take the dog. The leader says, no, Roberto, perhaps God wants the dog in your home to teach you something. Listen, you're not head of your home, but not for the reason that you think. A head is not just someone who gives orders to everybody. A head is someone who brings solutions, who thinks out what needs to be done. Roberto weeps, how can a dog be worth all that trouble? He's tearing the whole family apart, and he's not even a person. Pray for me that I don't laugh and I get through this. And someone else says, listen, maybe the dog shouldn't be in the apartment. Maybe you're right, but maybe God wants you to learn to love the dog anyway. Come on, Roberto, you're losing your wife. You're making the old woman unhappy. The problem really isn't the dog, it's you. Now, this is an example. He's not trying to be facetious or make a joke of this. He's dead serious. Roberto says, oh, I can't. They say, don't worry. We're going to pray for you. Here's their solution. We're going to pray for you that God will give you the power to accept the dog. So come here and sit in the middle of the room. We gather around him, lay hands on him and pray. God, give him victory over the dog. Lord, make him love his wife, his mother-in-law, and the dog. Roberto starts to weep. Finally, he says, okay, I think now I can do it. It's about that mechanical. All right, we say. Now on your way home, stop in the store and buy the dog a new coat. If you don't have any money, we'll give you some. You must learn to love that dog. Now, you're working out a solution to the problem in your home, Roberto. Now, listen to this. What Roberto doesn't know, at the same moment, his wife is in another cell. And she, too, is telling the story of the dog. And my wife is saying, listen, he's the head of your house, and you have to submit to him. Even your mother must submit to him. If he said the dog goes, the dog goes. Why don't you see if you can find another place for the dog to stay, and you and your mother can go see him once or twice a week. Well, I never thought of that, she says. He really is the head, and we have to obey him. I'll talk with Mom. She goes home and convinces Mother to give the dog away, and about that time, Roberto walks in with the new coat for the dog. Confusion reigns. Two cells, if they'd all been meeting together like they should, they wouldn't have been getting two sounds out of the same trumpet. And his conclusion, you can't accomplish things like that in church on Sunday. That's right. That's his conclusion. He's dead serious. The next week we hear reports of what happened. Roberto says, you won't believe what happened when I get home. We all rejoice together. The fifth week we move to point two. They've only been a month on the dog. Point two is husbands must love their wives. And here comes the mystical part of the marriage. And you know what the solution is in the discipleship meeting? They're all to take a rose and a box of candy to their wives, and home becomes heaven. I I mean, we should laugh to keep from crying. It's that bad. So he concludes, you see, the cells are not just for speaking about heaven. They don't. We talk about the cost of living, about politics, and you name it, about everything. Church has become group therapy sessions. Teaching the Word of God is substituted with social issues and problems at home, domestic problems. So total submission is what's taught in and by these groups. Total submission to your shepherd. The sheep are literally to lay down their lives at the feet of these men who teach those things. And I haven't just gone in there and lifted out passages. You can hear it and read it over and over again. But they are to make total submission to these men. One elder said, I've ministered in his church, and I give you quotes in these messages. Lay down your life before me, and I will mold you and make you into my image. Ortiz goes on to say, he didn't say that, a minister said that, I ministered in his church. A disciple is one who learns to live like his teacher. It is not a communication of knowledge of the word, but of the teacher's life. We must stop being speakers and become fathers. Total commitment to these men is demanded and expected. One of Ortiz's disciples came to him, and he quotes this all over the world. This disciple said to him, I've given my life to God for you, for your sake. Listen to that. For your sake, he said to him. If something happens to you, it happens to me. So my life is in your hands. If you need my blood, it's yours. If you need my car, it's yours, my home, everything. Then they quote 1 John that we ought to be willing to lay down our lives for brothers. Well, it's one thing to be willing to lay down your life for your brother. It's another thing to make such total commitment to a man that you say, I lay down my life for your sake. Even if you give your life for your brother, it's for Jesus' sake. You see, such commitment belongs only to Jesus, where you say, I lay down my life. You never lay down your life to a man, for a man, but never to a man. And this is what Paul warned was going to happen, that men would arise who would make disciples to themselves. Acts 20, verse 30, also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things. And if anything's perverse, it's what we've been seeing the last 2 weeks. Perverse means a perversion of the truth. They will arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. You see, I've noticed all through this, it's interesting that you can't get one church member in 10,000 to make such total commitment to Jesus. And they flock to submit themselves to bondage to these men. Men who half the time are confessing nothing but weakness and failure and past deceptions. But, strange it may seem, this is the way neo-discipleship is supposed to work. Because as one said, you don't submit yourself to someone who's perfect. You don't submit yourself to someone who doesn't have problems. He said, I submitted to K.S., that's his name, and learned much from his mistakes. Can you imagine the Apostle Paul or any of the apostles saying, follow me, but be sure to carefully observe all of my mistakes because you'll be able to profit from my errors. So total discipleship is taken to mean that you're to submit yourself to your elder, to your shepherd, even when he's wrong, even when it isn't in line with the Word of God. If he tells you, a wife, to submit in everything to your husband, that means to the limit of your faith, as we showed you last week. If it's go to the races, submit to impure sexual acts, you are to obey your shepherd. If he says don't go to certain meetings, don't listen to certain tapes, don't read after certain ministries, if he says to you, you have to do so-and-so today, you don't even answer back. You just submit. As Ortiz said, when a visitor comes to our church, we don't any longer now ask people who will take them in if they need, you know, a meal or to stay overnight. He says, we go and command. He says, I'll go up to man and say, you there, you are to take these people into your house. And you know his conclusion? We do this because the sheep are slaves in the kingdom of God. Slaves in the kingdom of God, slaves in the kingdom of Juan Carlos Ortiz, slaves in the kingdom of submitted body teaching, but sons in the kingdom of God. Amen. For those of you who have not heard our tape, Sonship Faith, we recommend you send for it. Or you here this morning, you listen to it. Sonship Faith. No, you're not slaves in the kingdom. You're sons in the kingdom. But you're taught, if you're not submitted, then you're open to deception and error. And I listened to a tape made in the church where I had gone a few years ago and taught the faith message. In fact, he came all the way to Florida from Tennessee to get me to teach the message of faith. And I did for a number of days, and they received the word joyfully. But he got off into the submitted body teaching and has given up the faith message. But I listened to one of the tapes at one of their ordination services recently, where they were ordaining shepherds and elders out of his church. And one of the speakers said this, said to the people, "Your shepherd is the vine, and ye are the branches." Remember last week where one of the leaders said that the shepherd is the door and you go in and out through him? Well, this is the same error, John 15. Your shepherd is the vine and ye are the branches, and you must abide in him or you can't bear fruit of yourself. You're to plant yourself in your shepherd. This is blasphemy. Amen. Only Jesus is the vine. We are in him. We are to plant ourselves in him. We bear fruit, he says, through him. No man. This is the same pastor who allows this sort of teaching in his church, and teaches it himself, by the way, and worse things than this, himself. When I was there, went out to lunch with him one day and offered him all my literature, as I generally do to the pastor. Oh, he says, "I don't read anyone else's literature anymore." He said, "I began to follow the literature of a man, and I got off into error and deception." He says, "I can't trust myself to read what man has written, so I just stay in the Word. I just stay with the Word." Now, that sounds pious till you realize he's on the front row taking notes of all my sermons. Well, what I teach is what's in my literature. See, it didn't make any sense for him to have me there. He should do all the teaching to follow that line. And I thought, well, now, this man, if he's afraid of being deceived, should he be trying to teach people?
That's right.
See, he's the same man that taught that he was easily deceived. And that's what he is now. And he admitted on this same tape where they're ordaining elders that he doesn't fully understand all that's going on in neo-discipleship, submitted body, but he knows it's God. These are the men that tell us we are to submit to them, that are always confessing a lack of understanding that is new to them. And he went on to say, after he gave up the faith message, one brother told me he prayed a prayer and he didn't get an answer to it on his time schedule, so he gave up the faith message and got into something else and finally got into a submitted body. And he said to his people, "I prayed and prayed," trying to seek solutions, but he said, "the heavens were as brass. And finally the Lord spoke to my heart and said, if you get any help, it'll be from man and not from me." Listen to this. Boy, if you don't know an angel of light when you hear one talking, God help you. And he said, "great peace came over me." That's feeling. "I took a plane and submitted myself," and he names one of these four men from Fort Lauderdale. And he said to him, listen to what he says to one of these leaders from Florida, "I submit my soul to you. Ask unto the Lord." Now, there is something seriously wrong with a minister who would submit his soul to a man, the best of men. But there's something far worse wrong with a leader, charismatic leader, who would let a man submit his soul to him and not rebuke him. And that's why I say these men who are leading in this are in the greatest depths of bondage and error. They are in the bondage of deceiving spirits to let a man say that. And this man that he submitted his soul to said, and I'm quoting you right off their tapes, and I've ministered with these men, all of them, I know them. He said, "you are to recognize and relate yourself to your shepherd that God has set in the body. They'll be like the stars of heaven to you, and you can set your compass on them to guide you." Men, men. He said, "lay down your life at the feet of your elder. You can't receive revelation apart from your elder. You know God through your shepherd." Why, even the Catholics don't go that far. I mean, they make some strong statements, but that's the strongest I've ever heard out of a man who still calls himself Southern Baptist. Ministers, nothing but fear and bondage, you see. These men who are basically insecure themselves find the sheep easy prey, and especially widows and unmarried women. They're told, "you have no covering, you have no protection, you're open to deception." And they're actually now equating neo-discipleship cell groups with the kingdom of God. This new divine order, one of them said, is God setting up his kingdom. Complete submission is what you're asked to give. They tell you what religious TV programs you could watch, what literature to read, what meetings you can or can't attend. You're forbidden to attend full gospel businessmen's meetings. You're forbidden to look at the 700 Club on TV. You're forbidden to listen to certain ministries like faith ministry, the body ministry, deeper life ministry. My books are on the banned list, that's obvious. Satan has appeared to more than one and told them not to read my literature, who were in submitted body. I think that speaks for itself. That speaks for itself. One of them said, one of the shepherds, I know him personally, said to one of the sheep, you tell me all of your past, everything, your sins and everything. That'll keep you submitted to me. Why, yes, he'd be afraid he'd tell on him if he didn't. See, you're to take the vows of submission just like in marriage. And if you get your eyes open to get loose of the snare, you have to go through what is called a de-sheeping process. I think there's some here who've gone through it. Yeah, de-sheeping process. You take back your committal, your vows, your pledge of allegiance to them. Because they say you have to take them back publicly because that's the only way you can get removed from their protection and covering of revelation. So you're actually under that and you have to get loose from it. And then the shepherd can declare you separated from the true body. Now I want to say something and I want you to hear me clearly that this has all the earmarks of magical ritual and the same sort of vows and oaths people take to join the cults, Freemasons, Satanism and the like. And I'm going to suggest for people who hear this message over the world is that they don't go through a de-sheeping process, but they repudiate publicly their relationship with this erroneous neo-discipleship teaching and then go through the steps of occult deliverance. Amen. That's strong medicine, but I'll tell you, we're living in the last hour, and there's a dividing by the Word of God between those who are going to follow the Word of God and those who are going to follow the Word of man. It's that plain. I could make it even stronger, but it'd be misunderstood. Renounce your association with the cult of neo-discipleship, and then go through the steps of occult deliverance. Even if you've gone through them before, go through again. If you don't know what that is, and we will send you a free tract that'll show you the steps to take. Now, in this bondage, women are completely robbed of all their freedom. As one of the pastors said, women are not made to think. So they are forbidden to meet together unless they have a covering and a shepherd. I find the women are going to have a meeting here in this church next Thursday. You know how I found out about it? She told me last night. Ladies, who's your covering? Well, as long as you know he'll be there, I won't have to show up. But women are not allowed to meet together without their covering. A woman, a wife, can't speak, can't even stand up in some meetings and make an announcement without her husband or covering being present. She'll be asked, who's your covering? Sit down, your covering's not present. By the way, I don't know what they did with Lydia and the women in the book of Acts who met together without a covering, except the Lord. Body ministry is hindered. As one brother said, when we received the baptism of the Holy Spirit in this particular church, and you were there teaching on faith, that the gifts began to flow, the body was ministering and reaching out and reaching people in every area of their need. Faith was high, but he said after, and he names one of the leaders from Florida, after he came and taught on submitted body, he says the gifts stopped, body ministry stopped, women were no longer allowed to speak. If prophecy came, it came from the pulpit. And he said, I was even called out of order because I stood up and gave a testimony. Yeah. So he said, we were called in on the carpet because we weren't submitting in this church the way they thought we should. And the first question they ask you is, who's your shepherd? Of course, he said, I knew what they wanted. They won't accept the Lord as my shepherd because they'll say you're deceived. And he says, well, pastor, I want to do what's right. I don't want to be a rebel because they call you a rebel and everything else. He says, but I want to see it from the Word of God. Can you show me from the Word? He says, what you're doing isn't in the Word. What's happening here in this church isn't in the Word. Well, I said, it's a new wine magazine. He said, don't you read New Wine magazine? He said, pastor, I have to see it from the Word. He says, you have to get in it, get involved, then you'll see it in the Word. Someone said, Freeman says it's not in the Word. Well, he's not submitted. That's why he can't see it. You have to be in it to see it. Another said, his Deeper Life book doesn't teach that kind of discipleship. Well, he's not related to anybody, therefore he doesn't have all the light. Well, what light are they talking about? From God or from the angel of light? I've had that angel come to me and offer me revelation. Unlike them, I had sense enough to say I was going to stay with Jesus and his word. I didn't accept his revelation. What do they mean, light? They're always talking about you won't get any light. That's significant. 2 Corinthians 11 talks about that angel of light. And so you want to avoid the angel of light. Light is one thing. God is light. And so this brother, when they were in there on the carpet, said to the pastor, says, Pastor, don't you believe any longer in body ministry? You know, that was flowing before submitted body came in. Don't you believe in body ministry? Well, he said, certainly I do. He said, when I'm preaching the word and the body smiles back at me, he says, that really ministers to me. That's what I call real body ministry. You know, the sad part was he wasn't kidding. He meant that. Now, these cells, which Ortiz admits the term is not Bible, I think of the bondage they're in, and I see them in a cell, literally, a prison cell. These cells, he says, are to be small, closed meeting, 7 to 8 people. Ortiz says that Jesus, the great shepherd, could only take care of 12 disciples at one time, so how can we? You have to take each sheep in your arms, he says, as a baby, and you put the bottle in his mouth and feed him till he grows. So what we've got is a spiritual nursery. Another leader said, Jesus tells us to love everyone, even our enemies. He says, I can't love everyone. Listen to these confessions. I can't love everyone. That's why we have to form the small groups. Then we can learn to love them through practice, one at a time. Sounds pious, but it isn't Bible. You don't learn to love through practice. Did you learn to love your wife or husband through practice? If it took you a while to learn, then you just had two people living together. You either fall in love, as they say, that is, it just happens, or you're not in love. I mean, how do you learn to love through practice? Jesus says, love your enemies. And there's no way you can practice learning to love an enemy, because everything he does or says is opposed to you practicing loving him. You just have to love in spite of the fact that he's the way he is. And so all of their teaching, even on love, obedience, is a legalistic thing you do. It's a works religion. It's exactly what the book of Galatians is speaking against. The groups, as one said, are to be no larger than 12. 13 would be a Judas. You're to bind yourself to the one you're submitted to. You take the vows. You make no real decisions without their approval. You tell him all of your faults, your problems, your sins. As R.T. says, you meet together and confess your sins one to another. One brother here in our body now told me that he had a vision of the church in Melbourne, Florida, where he was. I don't mind saying where it is, because they are certainly not hiding their errors in teaching. He said he saw in the vision a man turning like a second hand on a clock, just going round and round, going nowhere, doing nothing. And there was no features, no color, just a gray, you know, neutral nothing. And said the Lord showed him that this submitted body teaching, this group there, were just involved in vainless repetitions, going nowhere, doing nothing. Now, how can these men set themselves up, claim such awesome authority that belongs only to an apostle, God-appointed apostle, and go around setting up submitted bodies, appointing elders in submission to them, bondage to them? How can they do that? It's because they first remove from the Bible all of the emphasis upon the supernatural nature of the appointment of an apostle, and that opens the way where they can appoint themselves. As Ortiz says, a pastor grows up to apostleship, and then he can go out and plant new churches. And then he gives Paul as an example. He grew from a new convert to a teacher and then an apostle. That isn't what Paul says in Galatians. He said that was a divine appointment from heaven. Galatians 1 and verse 1. Certainly Paul had to be a convert before he could be a teacher. He's talking about the order. He was a convert, then he was a teacher, then he moved out as the Lord sent him out, Acts 13, into the apostleship. That is the functioning of it. But he says here in Galatians 1 and verse 1 that that wasn't a thing he grew up in or man appointed to him at all. Paul, an apostle, not of man, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father.
Amen.
And he goes on to insist that he didn't even talk to other apostles, that he got his revelation, his gospel, directly from heaven. It would pay you, dear friend, to go read the book of Galatians. There is a submission taught in the Bible, but there's a balance in Scripture. Always a balance. You have a text like this, submit yourselves one to another, Ephesians 5:21, is to be balanced with submit yourselves to God, James 4:7. You see, somewhere there's a balance between submitting to one another and submitting to God. If submission to one another causes us to disobey God, as they teach, you know, even when a man's not with the word, you're to obey him, then there's something wrong with that kind of submission. There's a balance. The church is to be in loving submission to one another. We need one another, not bringing one another into bondage to each other, but the hand needs the eye. The hand can pluck a cinder out of the eye, and the eye can guide the hand as it does delicate tasks. This is the body of Christ, 1 Corinthians 12. We should be in submission one to another, that we're not lording it over one another. We're not unteachable, but that we are never demanding our rights, but considering the other better than ourselves, as Paul says, and to help one another and serve one another. But this isn't blind submission of one person to another. What may sound like a practical application of submission becomes bondage in this new teaching. Everywhere you find in Scripture a command, you'll find a balance. Obey them which have the rule over you. Well, that's us. And submit yourselves to us, the Bible says. But that's to be balanced with don't, and this is to us, lord it over God's heritage, but be examples to the flock. You see, there's always a balance. Let every soul be subject to the higher powers. There is no power but of God. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man, whether it's to the king or to the governor or to anyone in authority. Submit yourself to him. Now that's to be balanced with Acts 5:29, which I'd like you to look at. See, this submission to government authority or any kind of authority is to be balanced with Acts 5:29. Here where they command Peter and the apostles not to preach the word. Verse 29, then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Now, that is limited obedience, but total submission. For we go on to read in verse 40, and to him they agreed, and when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. You see, they submitted to the punishment because they refused to obey man and obey God. So we are to give a limited obedience, a total submission. That's the scriptural principle. It's in our Deeper Life book. It's on the tapes on submission to authority and non-resistance. A teaching command, wives, submit yourselves to your husband, is to be balanced with husbands, love your wives. The teaching, let every one of you love his wife as himself, is to be balanced, let the wife see that she respect her husband. And so when the Bible teaches one thing, it balances it with another scripture, not to contradict it, but to bring it all into proper focus and harmony with the total revelation. That's why people get into trouble when they take one verse, like him who knew no sin became sin for us, and they know nothing at all about the rest of the Bible, what it has to say about the atonement. Like in Leviticus chapter 6, where the sin offering became most holy, and the priest ate it, and if anything accidentally touched it, it became holy. After it had been offered, you see. So the sin offering was not an unholy thing, or it couldn't have been a sin offering. It was to stand in the place of the unholy person. So in all Scripture, there is a balance, and you have to know Scripture. When the Bible tells a wife to submit herself to her husband, it does not tell her, as submitted body teaching tells them, submit yourself to the limit of your faith, which means perverse sexual acts, go to the races, drink your beer, do whatever. I've had women confide in me, my husband wants me to commit perverse sexual acts. What should I do? I say, you don't have to submit when you sin against Jesus. Submission is taught. When they want you to drink, not read your Bible, not worship the Lord, not to pray in tongues, what do you do? Acts 5:29 is the principle. We ought to obey God rather than man. Now, you don't flaunt that before your husband. It didn't say that. But your first loyalty is to Jesus. We teach submission here to your husband and to those in authority, to the fivefold leadership, but it's a biblical submission. not as lords over the flock, but as examples, you see. And so any teaching on submission that tells a woman to sin against the light that Jesus has given her, any submission that teaches her to disobey her conscience is a perverse form of submission, and it's not biblical. You see, this would be to make Jesus' teaching on submission greater than his teaching on holiness.
Amen.
Our sin, our perfection. You have to take the whole revelation. He isn't going to tell you to submit to some wrong act, sin, just to hold to the principle of authority. You see, that would make his principle of authority greater than his teachings on purity and holiness. You see, the same Bible that teaches submission also says, be ye holy as God is holy. Be ye perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. The same Bible that says submit in everything also teaches abstain from every appearance of evil.
Amen.
Let's take the whole revelation. The Bible says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. And children, time and again, I mean up through 18 years of age, say, have asked me the same question. My parents won't let me do this or want me to do that that's wrong, or won't let me do something that's spiritual. What am I to do? First question, how old are you? I say, submit to the limit of where you would disobey Christ. I said, from there on, this is where the importance of the faith message comes in. Then you'll claim that God will open their eyes, deliver them, save them, baptize them in the Spirit, whatever they need. Bind those demons with your faith, whatever it is. But I said, at that point, it's Acts 5:29 for everybody. We ought to obey God rather than men. It is limited obedience even to your parents and total submission to the punishment or the consequences. That's plainly taught in the Word of God, friends. Get in it and you'll see. Now, that does not mean, and we don't have time to go into that. We've got tapes on the relationship between husbands and wives and parents and children. Does not mean that a child can flaunt his religion or spirituality before his parents. We didn't say that. If one Sunday they said, don't go to church, I say submit to them and claim that they'll let you go and this sort of thing. This isn't a permanent thing when you have faith anyway. You can claim that God will deliver them out of their bondage. But remember that submission is just to the limit of where you would start disobeying Christ. There's always a balance in Scripture. Submission is taught, but it's never blind slavery to some man. Paul and Barnabas didn't agree. Which one of them lost his covering? You see. They went their separate ways. Paul the apostle, with all the authority, yet did not try to coerce faith, did not try to move beyond what his authority was given him for. We find again and again in Scripture where the apostle won't misuse his authority. Here's a perfect example in 1 Corinthians 16 and verse 12. These men teach that you have to submit absolutely to your shepherd, to your authority. But here is the great apostle who probably had more authority than all put together. And here he deals with a new convert, Apollos. And he said, as touching our brother Apollos, I greatly desired him to come unto you with the brethren. But his will was not at all to come at this time. But he will come when he shall have convenient time. Hadn't Apollos heard submitted body teaching? Hadn't he heard that Paul was the authority? Hadn't he heard that he was to submit in all things? Apparently he had never heard from anyone but the Holy Spirit. Apollos didn't feel it was time to go, and Paul allowed him to have his way here. It was not some great matter that dealt with doctrine or heresy. He said, I greatly desired he would come, but he didn't want to. So he said, he'll come when he's ready. That's plain enough. And so there's always a balance in Scripture. Another error of these men, and it's all a part of the whole pattern and scheme to get you into bondage, is that they make much of their teaching that there's a plurality of elders taught in the New Testament. That you never find a pastor over a church, a single pastor. There's always a plurality of elders, they say. And of course, they will quote you a letter to Ephesians, a letter to Rome, and all where Paul writes to the elders. Acts 20, where he called the elders of the church at Ephesus. But what they don't tell you is that the church in those days, there were no denominations, that the church consisted of many congregations all over the city. When he'd write to Rome, he wouldn't write to the churches of Rome because there were no denominations. He'd write to the body, the church at Rome, made up of maybe 100 or 500 or 1,000 congregations with the elders appointed over them by the Lord. Here's a good example of the misuse of Scripture, 1 Peter 5, on the teaching of the plurality of elders. You see, the Bible does generally speak of elders in the plural, but remember, it's writing to the church at Rome, the church at Ephesus. It's writing to many, many congregations. 1 Peter 5, he says, the elders which are among you. So they say, see, it's always in the plural. But why don't they bother to read verse 1 of chapter 1 and to see to whom Peter's writing? And you'll find he's writing to many churches in many areas of the world. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Now, there's a lot of geography that he's writing to. Then he says, now, you elders in all of those places. Well, certainly would have to be in the plural, because there wouldn't be one elder or pope over all of that area. There's always a balance in Scripture. We have a plurality of elders here, teaching elders. You have a ruling elder. At one time, we had one elder because we didn't need many elders. When we started the work in Winona Lake, early in Claypool, we had one elder because that's all we needed, friends. But now we need more elders. We have more elders, not in submission to one another, as neo-discipleship teaches, but certainly in submission to one another, as the Bible teaches, and all of them in submission, contrary to what they say, to the pastor. Now, they don't come to me and say, can I go to Atlanta, Georgia, when we're talking about submission? Can I go to Atlanta, Georgia? I've got an invitation. No, I expect them to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit themselves. But I think it's not only courtesy, but it is beneficial to the whole body for them to keep the pastor informed how the Lord is leading them. They come and say, the Lord is leading me to establish a meeting here, and so on. And they share this. And sometimes I say, this is rare, but I say, and I say it because the Lord has shown me that's not what the Lord wants you to do, or he wants you to do it a little different way. Now, if they can't submit to that, they have no business here, because that's why God has set leadership in the body. You can't have 12 leaders. They go off in 12 directions. Somebody has to make final decisions. So that's a form of submission, but it isn't bondage that you've got to check everything out in your life with me, that you can't do anything unless you get my approval. When problems arise, theological questions arise, they don't hesitate to ask the benefit of my experience and study. That's the way it should be. But it's not, as one brother said of the church in Melbourne, he said, a group of us gathered together to pray for the meeting that night. And we got there a little early and headed for one of the rooms and said, one of the elders stopped us and said, where are you going? He said, well, we're going to intercede for the meeting. Well, he said, where's your covering? And they didn't have one. You accept Jesus and they won't accept that. And so you're not even free, you see, to pray in your church. We don't have that kind of submission here. We encourage you just to come and pray or stay at home and pray. Do whatever the Lord leads you to do. That we're not going to set up rules for you. It's true that you are to submit yourself to the divinely ordained leadership, but it's not blind submission in every area of your life. That's the purpose for which Christ set the fivefold ministry in the body, Ephesians 4. Why? He says to bring you to maturity. Not to get you to depend on me or upon us, but to bring you to maturity, equip you for the ministry, to bring you from the milk of the Word to the meat of the Word, to enable you to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit for yourself. You see, the mark of a successful ministry is whether or not I make you a disciple of Jesus. Nowhere in the Bible are we told to make disciples for ourselves. And so a ministry either succeeds or fails right at that point, whether or not it makes you a disciple of Jesus Christ. That is, whether or not you realize that you are that disciple. So when people tell you that you have to be under bondage in order to find true revelation and your true place in the body of Christ, then know that you can always answer, I've read Galatians. See, there are many areas of your life where there are no specifics given in the Word of God. There are great principles, as we show in the book, Deeper Life in the Spirit, to guide you. Principles. Sometimes people, some of you come and say, what should I do? I say, I can't tell you. I'll give you the principle. I'll tell you what the Word says. You have to make that decision for yourself. You see, I'll give you the light. I'll give you what the Word is saying. Then you must make up your own mind. There are principles. And one of the basic principles is the principle of Christian liberty. And these men are blind to this basic Christian principle the principle of Christian liberty, lacking the faith to walk by the Father by themselves, being in submission so long to denominational brainwashing and the system that has robbed them of the independent exercise of their faith, they think that everyone is a spiritual babe and needs a crutch to lean on. I found that when a man's free in the Spirit himself, he's not afraid to trust the people under him with the same freedom that he has. When a person has learned to walk with the Father by faith, when he's learned to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit for himself, when he's free himself, he isn't afraid to trust people with the same freedom with the Word of God. God-ordained leaders have authority, but it's never to coerce you or to rob you of your faith. Paul says this again in 2 Corinthians 1, 23 and 24. He speaks here of his authority to come to them and to discipline them because they have been disobedient. But he tells them why this authority is given him, not to coerce them or to rob them of the independent exercise of their faith. That's in the context. Verse 23 of 2 Corinthians 1. Moreover, I call God for a record upon my soul that to spare you, I came not as yet to Corinth. Some were saying, well, he doesn't go around and visit his churches. He says, one reason I didn't come to you was to spare you, because if I'd been there, I'd use the rod, the spiritual authority I have. But look, he says he has that authority, but what for? Not for that we have dominion over your faith. Amen. He says, I have all authority as an apostle, but I don't have dominion over your faith. But I'm a helper of your joy, for by faith you stand. Amen. You see, it's while he had all authority from heaven to discipline them, yet he said it's not an authority to bind you or bring your faith into subjection to me. Each member of the body is to be taught how to exercise his faith. That's what the Bible teaches. Each member of the body is to be encouraged to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit for himself. Each member of the body is to be encouraged to know the Word of God for himself. The body has many members. They don't have all the same function. In this teaching, follow me and I'll make you in my image, that a shepherd is to make a disciple in his own image, that a disciple is to be a duplicate of his shepherd. This is not Bible, because the body, Paul says, 1 Corinthians 12, is diverse, many operations, many ministries, and many different gifts. He says they all blend together. We're not all eyes, hand, feet. We're not to lose ourselves in some gray spiritual mass, some nursery somewhere where we get milk fed by these men. But we are to keep the diversity in the body. We're not all to be like one another. We're all to be like Jesus, but not like one another. There's a variety, and don't lose that distinctiveness in the body of Christ. Thank God they're all not like one, me or you or anyone. We're diverse, and you can help me. I can minister to you. Now, the primary stress of neo-discipleship is this, that if you're not under shepherds that they've appointed, if you're not under a covering that man has appointed, then you're open to deception and you can't receive the true revelation. Now, I want you to listen carefully. I'm going to close with this. The basic stress in this whole new movement is that if you're not under a covering and not submitted to a shepherd, you're open to deception. That very teaching is self-defeating for this group. Why? Because when they started to get this new revelation, they were not under coverings. They were not under shepherds themselves. How do we know then they're not deceived? They say you've got to be under all this not to be deceived, and they weren't under it when they were getting this. I mean, they're judged by the words of their own mouth. I stay with the Apostle Paul, stand fast therefore in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with a yoke of bondage. Amen, amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Would you stand up? Amen. Father, we know that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. And grant men and women the grace as they hear the word of the Lord on this deception to be willing to renounce all association with the teaching that would bring them into bondage, and not forsake their liberty in Christ Jesus. And to see that they are like the foolish Galatians, who, having begun in the Spirit, tried to be perfected in the flesh, were warned by the Word of God that this was bringing themselves back under the curse of the law. And if they're under the curse of the law, then they're under its penalties and under its death. God, set your people free in this hour from all bondage, charismatic or otherwise, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Praise the Lord.